Assalamu alaikum viewers, welcome to Virtual University and to your English lesson. In the past few lessons, we have looked at paragraph writing. Now we shall move forward and look at longer pieces of writing, which consist of several paragraphs. We will look at essay writing in today's lesson, and it shall continue for a couple of lessons. The problems we considered in sentence and paragraph writing are also the fundamental problems of longer composition. You have the same problems of unity, of coherence, and emphasis. While some topics can be treated in a single paragraph, others require more elaborate development. In longer compositions, we have problems of arrangement. A longer composition such as an essay, it divides itself usually into a number of parts. In what order shall we present them? How much emphasis should be given to each fact? These are some of the problems that one faces in writing an essay. Now, a lot depends on the purpose of your writing. If you are writing primarily to give information, then you need to be as exact as possible in the interest of clear, logical presentation of facts. And if you are writing to describe something, or to create an image or a picture, then you shall perhaps put less emphasis upon accurate measurement and more emphasis upon suggestive and revealing details. And if you are trying to tell a story, you will have to decide upon the point of highest interest and arrange your material carefully to give your reader a feeling or an illusion of taking part in the action. Writing an essay is not more difficult than writing a paragraph. There is only one difference: length. The principles of organization are the same for both. So if you can write a good paragraph, you can also write a good essay. Now we will first look at the process of writing. Writing usually takes place in steps, or you can say stages. And there are five stages or five steps in the writing process. The first one is getting ideas, and there are three ways to get ideas. I shall just quickly mention them and discuss them in detail later on. One is brainstorming, the other is clustering, and the third one is free writing. The second step is making a brief outline. The third step is writing the first draft. The fourth is revising what you've written. And the last step is proof reading. Right? Now, let us look at step one. How do you get ideas? I mean, nobody's born with ideas. You get them. and you get them from, primarily, from reading. So you realize how important reading is in a student's life. You get a lot of ideas from books, from reading journals, from reading magazines. You get ideas by talking to people, by listening to people talk. You pick up ideas all the time. When you hear two people arguing over some political event, you listen to different sides of the argument. You get ideas if you watch TV programs, if you listen to, if you watch talk shows, if you watch interviews, and you will notice that each person has his own way of looking at things. One person looks at things from one angle, another person looks at things from another angle. And in the process, it's a learning process, you pick up ideas, you might change your ideas, you might have had different ideas earlier, but you listen to two people talk on the TV, on a TV show, excuse me, and you change your views. In the same way, there are a lot of programs on current issues, and you will find that as you listen to people, as you listen to interviews, you are getting new ideas. I mean, it's not necessarily that you listen to political talks. You can, if you are interested in sport, you can listen to, you can hear, you can watch programs where important sports personalities are interviewed, and you are picking up ideas all the time. So you will get ideas from different sources, but for students your main source is reading newspapers. There are articles in newspapers, and if you read the editorial, because you will find the editorial of the newspaper, it sort of clinches the policy of that, the points that is being discussed in the editorial. There are articles in newspapers, and I always suggest to my students that for ideas, go to newspapers, go to magazines, go to journals, read books, you get a lot of ideas. Now, let us come back to essay writing. Now, if you were to write an essay, how would you go about it? There is one very, very easy way, and that is brainstorming. You jot down the points or ideas and the details as they come to your mind. Just write them down without putting them in any special order. I'm sure you have something to say about anything that you have been given to write on, right? You have your own ideas. Just put them down. Take pencil and paper and jot down all the ideas that come to you. Never mind what order. Don't worry about the arrangement. Just keep putting them down. Try to accumulate as many details as you can think of. Now, this is one strategy of beginning an essay. The first is getting the ideas. Jot them down. Right? That is called brainstorming. The other strategy is clustering. And here, you begin by writing your subject or your topic in the center of a blank sheet of paper. Write down the main idea, the main topic, the subject. And then as ideas keep coming into your mind, you put them down in boxes or in circles, right? Draw circles around those, and then you connect those ideas, and you will see, oh well, this one goes with this one. Now you will see a sample of clustering. Do you remember some lessons earlier? You read a paragraph on my neighbors, and the paragraph said that my neighbors, those who've just moved in recently, are a very noisy family. And the main idea was that the neighbors were noisy. And the paragraph went on to elaborate. It talked about children playing hide and seek. It talked about the daughter shouting Babaji, Babaji all day long. And then it talked about how as night time came, loud music blared from the neighbor's house. It was either the TV being switched on very loud, or it was music from the stereo. And then you had that their dogs, they also, and they played hide and seek at night time. And the dogs barked loudly, and they also took part in that, in their sports. And then in that essay, you remember, we said, the paragraph said, it concluded that there is a need for something to be done, and it talked about calling a meeting of the neighbors. Now if you look at the diagram, the diagram showing clusters, this is how you arrange your ideas as they come to you, and then you link them. You link one with the other, and you will say, well, this one goes under noise, this one goes under animals, this one goes under neighbors. And this is how you go about making clusters. Let's look at the third way, and that is free writing. This is also a very useful technique. Here, you just write down whatever comes into your mind about the topic. This is continuous writing. You continue writing for some time without stopping. Just put pen to paper and write, let's say for 10 minutes, and then you stop, and then you don't look at your work. Don't look at it for some time, then go back to it. Now when you are doing this sort of work, when you are free writing, and you are writing freely, do not stop to worry about grammar or spelling. In fact, at this stage, this should be far away from your mind. You should not worry about punctuation or grammar or spelling, right? Now, that was step one, getting ideas. Getting ideas, generating ideas to start your essay. Step two. Step two is that you, after you've jotted down the ideas on your paper, you prepare a rough outline. And your outline is going to be the backbone or the skeleton on which the rest of the writing will be built. It is the skeleton on which you will put the flesh, right? And your your outline will show at a glance the point of the paragraph and the support of that point. In one glance you will know. This is next paragraph, I'm going to write about this. Third paragraph, it will be this, right? Step two is when you prepare a rough outline. And it will help you to see if you need to do more writing to clarify your main point or its support. Now before I forget, in your free writing, which was part of step one, you go back to that writing after some time, and then you can add then you will realize, oh well, I need to add this bit and I need to add that bit. Now in step two, you learn how to write. We will talk about writing an outline in detail in your next lesson. Here I will just show you an example of an outline. Remember some weeks ago there was this passage on a celebrated man who dies, and the paragraph, if you can recall, it's talked about how when a celebrated man dies, his friends and enemies and all other people, how they in a way they write his biography. They don't actually write it, but the things that they say about the dead man relates his biography. And the outline could have been like this, a rough, sketchy outline. A, you talk friends and enemies, all the things that his friends would have said, all the things that his enemies would have said. And then you talk about his schoolfellows. What are the kind of things his schoolfellows would have talked about? Of course, they would have talked about his childhood days, about the pranks and the conversations that he had. And then somebody, especially his lawyer, number C could be what his lawyer has to say about him, the lawyer who's looking after his will. And some people will talk about the offices that he held, all the distinguished offices that he held, and all the great things that he did. And then what about his relatives? What did his relatives have to say about him? His nephews and grandnephews, and how they relate accounts of his acts of humanity and his virtues. So you have a sample of an outline. That was step two. The third step in writing an essay is that you actually write the first draft. This is when you have put all your ideas together, you have put them, you have sorted them out. This will go under this, this will go under this, these should go there, and then you actually begin to write. The purpose over here is to develop the content of your document. You have the ideas and you begin to develop it. So be ready at this stage. You should be ready to put in additional thoughts, additional details that didn't come to your mind earlier. Again, do not spend time correcting words or sentences. Whatever you've got over there, retain it, but keep adding on to it, because you never know words that you might remove now, you might decide to retain later on. So do not cut out anything, just keep adding and let it be there. Step four is revising, and this is the most important part of writing. It's a practice that our students do not indulge in. They are not encouraged to develop this habit. Whatever you write, revising means that you rewrite, build upon what you have written to make it better. Students tend to hand in what they've written without taking a look at it. They expect the teacher to make the correction. Of course, the teacher will correct them, but you do your bit. You've written something, go over it. I would rather the student correct his mistakes himself rather than wait for the teacher to do it. So revising means that you rewrite, build upon what you have written to make it better. It is at this stage that you try to get rid of unnecessary material. You try to improve on what you are going to retain. What you don't want, what you feel is irrelevant, throw it out, cut it out. But what you feel that you must retain, see if you can improve on it. Excuse me. Try to improve on what you feel that you must retain. A typical revision means writing one or two more drafts. One draft you've written already, you revise it, leave it, go back to it again. Even if you go back to a piece of writing after say 10 minutes, you will find that you want to make changes in it. I always feel that there is always room for improvement, and in writing, the more you write, the more you'll get into the habit of revising what you've written. And when you revise, you will find that your revision is definitely better than what you've written earlier. What you revised, what you produced second time is better than what you wrote the first time. Now, here at this stage, you insert details that you left out. You may put in transition words which would make smoother reading. And if you are working on a word processor, take out a hard copy so that you can see the entire document at one time. Step 5 is proofreading. And this is the final stage in the writing process. It means checking carefully for spelling, grammar, punctuation, and other mistakes, other errors. Use your dictionary for this purpose. Proofreading is often hard work, and students want to avoid proofing. If proofing is done carefully, it will ensure that your written work looks as good as possible. Now, these were the 5 steps in the process of writing. Whatever you write, you will notice that if you follow these steps, the work that you produce will definitely be better. There is no single correct way of writing English. Good writing depends on a set of specific skills, and these skills are involved in writing. Three skills are involved in writing. The first one is the skill of communication, the skill of putting your ideas across to the reader. Number 2 is the skill of organizing your ideas in the shape of sentences and paragraphs. And the third skill is the stylistic skill, the skill of style, achieving the right level of formality or achieving the right tone for your writing. Now, these skills will not come to you at once. It is over a period of time, after a lot of writing, if you do a lot of term papers, do a lot of written assignments, gradually you will overcome the fear of writing, you will learn to put across your ideas to your readers, you will learn to organize your ideas, give them some shape, and you will learn to use the right tone. A lot of people think of writing as problem solving. They say it's a form of problem solving. The writer, they say, has 2 tasks before him. The writer has the task of generating ideas, that is the first one. And you as a student also, when you have to write assignments, you have to generate ideas. And the second task is the task of composing those ideas into some sort of shape, that is, giving structure to those ideas. Now, all writing, whether it is journalistic writing or academic writing, academic writing is writing a report, writing an essay, writing an assignment, a term paper, or some project work. All these things involve writing. Now, all writing has structure. There is first the introduction, then the main body in which the ideas are developed, and third, the conclusion. So let me repeat, all writing has structure, and the structure is very simple. It is in three parts: the introduction, the main body, and the conclusion. Let us look at the introduction. The introduction is concerned with the topic or the subject of writing. In the introductory paragraph, you will state the problem or the issue, whatever you are writing on, in a few general statements, right? to attract your reader's attention, and you will write a thesis statement to say how you intend to treat the topic of your essay. The thesis statement is just like the topic sentence in a paragraph. Have you got the point? The thesis statement, which you will write in your introductory paragraph, will state how you intend to treat the topic. It is similar to the topic sentence in a paragraph. Now, how would you try to catch the reader's attention so that the reader would want to continue reading? Now, this can be done in a number of ways. You can pose a question, you can use a quotation, an apt quotation, mind you, you can use a dialogue, you can have a striking description or an image in words, or you can make a controversial statement, a statement that would make your reader sit up and want to read on. Or you could develop a historical perspective or a background. Start with the history of whatever you are writing on. Or you can begin by making an appeal for some action or for change. Now, all these that I said are ways of trying to catch your reader's attention. You will be very careful. You will choose the one that suits your purpose of writing. Not all of them are suitable, right? The next thing is the main body of the essay. This is the second part of the essay, the major part. And this is where you develop the main idea with the help of examples and details. This part consists of more than one paragraph, and each paragraph develops a subdivision of your topic. So the number of paragraphs will vary with the number of subdivisions. You can organize the ideas either by chronological order or by way of importance, just as you did for a single paragraph. And the third part of your essay is the conclusion. And here, in the third and the last part, you draw your conclusion. there are many ways of ending your composition. You could create a feeling of finale, a feeling, well, that all right, now it's coming to an end. Now this may take the form of a summary or a review of the main points discussed in the body of the essay. Here you may even propose recommendations. You may even give your decision, right? Your opinion. Now, we will look at, on your screen, you will see the diagram, and you will see in graphic form what you have learnt today. You have the three parts of the essay. The first part is the introduction, the second part is the main body, and the third part is the conclusion. Now, in your introduction, you will have a general statement or a number of statements, and with those statements, you will have your thesis statement. The thesis statement, in the thesis statement, you will show how you are going to treat the topic. Then you move on to the main body. Now, over there on your screen, you are just shown three. These are three paragraphs. It's not necessary that you write three paragraphs in the main body. It can be more than three paragraphs. It could be five paragraphs, six paragraphs. It all depends on what you're writing, what is the purpose of your writing, and how much material you've got, how much content you've got. It is here that you are going to develop the content of your essay. And notice that each paragraph has a topic sentence, a supporting evidence, which could be in the form of illustrations, examples, facts, figures, right? And then there will be a concluding sentence. That is for one paragraph. The same pattern you will follow for the next paragraph. You will have the topic sentence, you will have supporting evidence, and you will support your evidence by giving examples, by giving facts, figures, statistics, right? And you will have a concluding sentence. And the same thing will continue till you have said all that you have to say. And the third part will be the conclusion. And again, your conclusion will be either a restatement of what has been said earlier, it could be a summary. You could summarize the points that you made in the main body, and you can add something. It's not necessary that you confine yourself to a summary or a restatement. It all depends on what you are writing, on your topic and your purpose. I'm sure you've noticed that I keep repeating, it all depends on the topic of your writing, on the topic, on the subject of your writing, and on the purpose of your writing, right? And you have to give your opinion or your decision. And sometimes you are even required to make recommendations if you are dealing with a problem and you would like to recommend that certain steps be taken. It is here, in this part, the third part, that you will make your recommendations, your suggestions for any action or any steps that have to be taken. Now, I would like you to look at the paragraph, the slide on paragraph. Notice it's the same pattern. the topic sentence, and then you've got support, 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 which is in the form of facts, figures, examples, statistics, whatever, and then you've got a concluding sentence. So this, if you have learned to write a paragraph, you will have no difficulty in writing an essay. The only difference is of length, how you expand your ideas. Right? Now, in essay writing, paragraphs are written and designed to serve as part of a longer composition. In a skillfully written essay, each paragraph has its own proper place, just as each word has its proper place in a coherent, emphatic sentence. Now, when you are writing, if you revise your work, you will realize that, this paragraph should not be over here, this paragraph should come earlier. So in your, in step 4, where you revise, after you've written your essay, go back and look at the paragraphs. Look at the order in which the paragraphs are coming. And you might want to change their position. That this paragraph, paragraph A, should not be there. It should be where paragraph C is. And when you are revising, you can make all these changes. Just as there is a problem of transition from one sentence to another within the paragraph, so there is some problem when dealing with a group of paragraphs. So you can see that writing an essay is essentially the same as writing a paragraph. It has the same problems, the problems of transition, the problem of unity, the problem of coherence, and the problem of emphasis. So when you are writing, you can juggle with your paragraphs. When you revise your paragraph, see which one. Sometimes we don't realize it, but when you revise, we realize that paragraphs ought to be shifted, and you can do that. And as you can see, writing an essay is essentially the same as writing a paragraph. The difference is of length. Now, we will just check your understanding of the material presented in this lesson. And I would like to check your understanding. And there are a number of questions. Let us see if you can handle them. Number one, writing is a skill that can be learned with practice. Is this statement true or false? Writing is a skill that can be learned with practice. True or false? Yes, it is a skill that can be learned with practice. So it's a true statement. Number two, an effective paragraph is one that A, makes a point, B, provides specific support, C, makes a point and provides specific support, D, none of the above. So, what is an effective paragraph? An effective paragraph is one that makes a point and provides specific support. So, it is statement number C that is correct. Number three. The sentence that states the main idea of a paragraph is called the topic sentence. Now, is this statement true or false? It's a true statement because the sentence that states the main idea of a paragraph is called the topic sentence. Question number four. Pre-writing strategies can help a writer find A, a good angle to write about, B, a good main point to make about the topic, C, enough details to support the main point, D, all of the above. Now, look at that question again. Pre-writing strategies, what can they do? They can help the writer provide a good angle. It's from the points that he notes down, a good main point to make about the topic. It can provide enough details, or does it provide all of the above? And if you recall, it's all of these points. Number 5, in the early stages of the writing process, you should not be concerned with spelling, punctuation or grammar. Is this a true statement or a false statement? And you know that it's a true statement. Number 6. A brief plan of the paragraph or composition is known as an outline. True or false? A brief plan of the paragraph or composition is known as an outline. True or false? It's true. Number 7. Your first concern when you start writing should be A, spelling, B, content, C, grammar, D, punctuation. Now, out of those 4 things, which should be your first concern? And your first concern should be content. Number 8. 2 common ways of organizing a paragraph are using a chronological order and order of importance. 2 common ways of organizing a paragraph are using a chronological order and order of importance. Is this a true statement or a false statement? It's a true statement. Number 9. The words first, next, then, also, another, and finally are known as signal words. They are also called transition words. True or false? Is this statement true or false? Yes, it's a true statement. Number 10. The purpose of proofreading is to check for errors. Errors in grammar, in punctuation, in usage and spelling, and all of these. Now, what is it that you do when you are proofreading? When you are proofreading, you check for errors, and you check for errors in all 4 areas. You check for errors in grammar, you check for errors in punctuation, you check for errors in usage, and you check for errors in spelling. Right? You even check your sentences, the way your sentences have been constructed. So, the purpose of proofreading is to check for errors in all of these areas that are mentioned over there. So, how many points did you get correct? I hope, and you should have got all 10 correct. Now, in today's lesson, you looked at essay writing. You looked at the different parts of the essay, the introduction, the main body, and the conclusion. Right? And you looked at the paragraph as well. And you noticed that it's the same technique that is followed. The same technique that you followed in writing a paragraph, you follow it while writing an essay, right? If you can write a paragraph, a good paragraph, you can also write a good essay. In your essay, you have to develop the contents. The contents could be developed in a matter of 4 paragraphs, 5 paragraphs, 6 paragraphs, 10 paragraphs. Now, if you remember, I set you some work. That was to write a paragraph on some topics. And the topics that were given you were arranged marriages, population explosion in Pakistan, and computers. I asked you to write a paragraph. Now, I would like you to write an essay. You can write, choose one of the 3 topics, write an essay, and I would like you to follow the 5 steps that were outlined for you earlier. Step 1, storming, brainstorming. You can follow any one of the techniques that I mentioned, free writing, clustering, brainstorming. Get your ideas. If you can read up on any of these topics, jot down those ideas and then make a rough outline. See how you arrange your ideas. Right? After that, write the first draft. After you've written the first draft, leave it for some time. Then revise it, then rewrite it, take out the bits that you think are unnecessary or irrelevant, add in what you think is required, then revise it. And the last stage would be that you would proofread it. In the last stage, you will check for spelling mistakes, for grammar mistakes, for punctuation mistakes, for usage and spelling mistakes, right? And show these essays to your instructor, because we are approaching the end of the course. And sometime in your exam, later on, we might ask you to write an essay. So write on any one of these topics and show your essay to your instructor. That's all for now. See you next time. Allah Hafiz.